Good morning, church family.
My name is Sammy, she, her pronouns. I'm so glad to have so many of you in the sanctuary on this beautiful day. And for all of our friends at home, I hope you are outside drinking coffee and joining us for worship. Our next Young Families gathering is this Tuesday at 6:30 p.m. at Switchback Gear Exchange on Plainfield. Don't miss the chance to squeeze in a fun summer evening with your first church friends at a local coffee and bike shop with live music and fantastic food. The youth room is getting a makeover. The grand reopening will be next Sunday after worship for the whole community to see the new space. We hope you will check it out. We are looking for cooks and drivers to help prepare and deliver healthy meals to elders from the Powhatan Native American community living in and around the Grand Rapids area. All aboard! Homecoming Sunday is just 3 weeks away. We hope you will join us for fun, food, and games. Would you like to help with the food or other parts of the event? Email info@grfumc.org for more information or to sign up to help. Are you interested in becoming a new member or learning more about First Church? Then you are invited to join Pastor Steve and I for a membership exploration class on September 17 after worship. For more information on this opportunity or any of the others, visit grfumc.org/news. To financially support the many ministries of First Church, place your offering in one of the offering stations at either entrance to the sanctuary, or go online to grfumc.org/give. Your gifts enable valuable ministry and mission work in our community and beyond. Thank you.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
A joy to see you this morning. Will you join me in the call to worship? Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. We belong to God. When we feel overwhelmed, God is on our side. When we are afraid, God will keep us safe. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. Blessed be the Lord. The Lord be with you, and also let us pray. Lord God, maker of heaven and earth, we gather together in your name. We come as living sacrifices to offer you our worship and thanksgiving, our praise and our prayers. Come among us, living Lord, through the power of your Holy Spirit, transform our hearts and minds so that we may recognize your presence, hear your voice, know your will, and walk in your way. This we pray in the name of Jesus the Christ, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. You may be seated. The Word of God comes to us this morning from Psalm 124. If it had not been the Lord who was on our side, let Israel now repeat. If it had not been the Lord who was on our side when our enemies attacked us, then would they have swallowed us up alive when their anger was kindled against us? Then the flood would have swept us away. The torrent would have gone over us. Then over us would have gone the raging waters. Blessed be the Lord who has not given us as prey to their teeth. We have escaped like a bird from the snare of the fowlers. The snare is broken and we have escaped. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Now the children and their backpacks are welcome to come forward. Good morning, friends. Happy Sunday. Who here already started school? Anybody? Cavill did. Who here starts school tomorrow morning? Oh, my goodness, it's so many hands. And who's starting school later in the week, like Tuesday? Oh, yeah, or later on. Or in September when preschool starts. Woohoo! Friends, I am so glad that you are here because today we are going to do a special blessing for your backpack, but also for you as you head back to school. I wonder, what are some of the things that you put into your backpack before you go to school? What do you bring, Parker? Gym shoes, markers, folders, yeah. Glue sticks, books, absolutely. What else do you bring? Lunch, yeah, what else? Snack, good call. Water bottle, yeah, David. Yeah. Yeah, watermelon, you silly goose. Maybe, that'd be a pretty heavy backpack, wouldn't it? Friends, you bring so many things to school, and you need those things when you're at school, right? They help you to learn and to make connections with the other kids in your class and to make a connection with your teacher. Yeah. Did you know that your teachers put something in your backpack when you come home every day? Do you know that beyond homework, or your school folder that goes back and forth, they put a little bit of hope right into your backpack. They hope that you have a good dinner. They hope that you get to play when you get home. They hope that you get to have a good night of sleep. They hope so many wonderful things for you. And then when you get home again, somebody you love sometimes fills that backpack right back up with more hope and blessing that you have a wonderful day at school. And it's kind of like our backpacks help us complete this circle of hope and blessing back and forth from school to home every day. Have you, raise your hand if you know who your teacher is this year. Oh, yeah. Keep your hand up if you think your teacher is definitely the kind of person who's going to put some hope and blessings into your backpack every day when you go to school and come home. Oh, that's excellent. Well, I would love to invite Pastor Sue to come up because we are going to share a little blessing with everyone.
I am so glad that you brought all your backpacks. They are beautiful and cool. Can you take them off and put them in front of you? Super Mario, awesome. Now, we are thinking that teachers could probably use a blessing too, don't you think? Yeah? So if you out there are a teacher, or a student who's going back to school, would you please stand for this blessing so that we can see you? Could you do that? Excellent. Now, beloved congregation, if you feel so moved, would you perhaps, if there is a person standing close to you, would you mind moving to them and maybe placing a hand on their shoulder to be part of this blessing? We'll give you a moment to do that. Everybody all set? Let us pray. God of learning, of new things and change, be with these students and teachers as they return to the classroom. Keep them curious. Give them courage. Surround them with loving kindness as they make new friends and foster relationship and encounter challenges and laugh a lot. Allow these backpacks to be a link between home and school, a reminder that the person who carries it and the teachers who teach are loved by you and by this church family. Amen. Thank you so much for sharing in the gift of learning.
And to remind you of this blessing that you received and the fact that you matter greatly to God and to this community of people, to your teachers, and to the other kids in your class, I have a backpack tag for you. And you can put this right on your backpack. It says you matter, and it's colorful. And you can get one today. Teachers, big kids going back to school, you can have one too, because they are pretty cool. All right. And now I will exit first, and then Marianne has something to share too. So friends who are in preschool all the way through sixth grade, if you would like to come, bring your backpack, follow those boys, and we will go to our class. Adults, you can retrieve your kids after worship in room 204.
So tall. No, I'll do this. I like this. Okay, I'll be very careful. Good morning. I'm Marianne Venskis, and I am the director of the FUMC MLK Tutoring Center, which has been a longstanding partnership and ministry between FUMC and Martin Luther King Leadership Academy, which is located at 645 Logan. This is its 35th or 36th year of partnership, and I started as a volunteer there about 13 years ago, and then they just couldn't get rid of me, so now I'm running the show. There is a saying, a teacher takes a hand, opens a mind, and touches a heart. So just a quick show of hands, how many people had a teacher that taught you how to read? Wow, a lot of good readers. Taught you how to subtract, taught you how to multiply, taught you how to build a birdhouse, shop. You had a teacher that told you to stop talking. You had a teacher that kept you in for recess because you were misbehaving. You had a teacher that made you laugh. You had a teacher that gave you a break when you did not deserve one. You had a teacher you will never forget because of how they impacted your lives. Wow. In the spring, we'll get back to that in a second. In the spring of 2022, wonderful donors and FUMC Tutoring Center supporters, Ray and Kristen Abraham, matched donations to the FUMC MLK Tutoring Center up to $10,000. The congregation and the Tutoring Center's supporters and community met that goal and surpassed it, and we were able to raise $23,597 with the match. The funding went towards enriching and supporting our long-standing partnership with MLK. Ray and Kristen have put the offer on the table again, or maybe we'll call it a school desk. Any funds that the Tutoring Center receives from today until October 31st will be matched up to $10,000. The funds we raise will go directly into MLK classrooms, helping support our MLK teachers. Did you know that a recent study found that more than one-third, about 35% of educators are considering leaving the profession? In addition, there's this hidden piece of school finance That's monies that are raised by PTAs, funds that pay for additional supplies, field trips, and most importantly, to support teachers in classrooms. Low-income schools like MLK typically do not have PTAs, and that's because their parents that have children in those schools are spread very thin due to the complex issues surrounding poverty. Teachers are the backbone of our communities, fostering curiosity and creativity, building skillful individuals, and strengthening informed citizens. A great teacher who feels supported by their community is one of the most important resources we can provide students. It's becoming ever more apparent that this congregation's support of MLK is not just a warmly accepted bequest, but crucial funding. When you are moved to give to this fundraiser, you can do so in the name of a teacher that impacted your life. A teacher who showed you patience, made you laugh, gave you some slack, and one that supported you. On Sunday, October 22nd, we will share the names of these teachers during the morning announcements. And I will also be talking to you again, because you can't get rid of me, now that I know I can stand on this thing and be really tall, how literacy truly impacts social justice. Giving is easy. You can do it online at grfumc.org/MLKGive. I know you got all that just then, but you can just look on the FUMC website. And when you go to our donor page, there's a place for you to put a name into the memo line. And for right there, that's where you're going to put that teacher's name. And you can also do it via check. And in the memo line of your check, you can put the name of a teacher. So thank you so much for your time, and happy back to school.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chris. Our gospel reading today comes from the Gospel according to Matthew, and the translation I'm reading is from the Common English Bible. You might be used to the title used in the Gospels for Jesus, the Son of Man. The Common English Bible translates that, the human one. So heads up. Now, when Jesus came to the area of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say the human one is?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others Elijah, and still others Jeremiah or one of the other prophets." He said, "And what about you? Who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter said, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Then Jesus replied, "Happy are you, Simon, son of Jonah, because no human has shown you this. Rather, my Father who is in heaven has shown you. I tell you, you are Peter, and I'll build my church on this rock. The gates of the underworld won't be able to stand against it. I'll give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Anything you fasten on earth will be fastened in heaven. Anything you loosen on earth will be loosened in heaven." And then he ordered the disciples not to tell anybody that he was the Christ. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Good morning, saints. Good morning, sinners. Good morning, saints and sinners online. My name is Jenny Browne. I know most of you, but there might be some of you sitting here who are wondering who I am. I'm a United Methodist clergy person currently serving on the conference staff as clergy assistant to the bishop and director of Connectional Ministries, the longest title on the staff. I am here because I have my charge conference membership here. And I do that because I was once the associate pastor here from 06 to 11, and because I'm married to your music director. Maybe you've heard this one before. After a long illness, a woman died and found herself at the gate of heaven. While she was waiting for St. Peter to arrive, she peeked in through the pearly gates. And there she saw a road paved with gold bricks and angels sitting on clouds playing harps. Ah, it was beautiful. Peter arrived, welcomed her, and she said, "Oh, this is such a beautiful place. How do I get in?" "Well," said St. Peter, "you just have to spell a word." "What word is that?" the woman asked. "Love," St. Peter said. The woman correctly spelled the word love, and Peter ushered her into heaven. About a few years later, St. Peter asked the woman if she would substitute for him at the gates, as he had another appointment that day, and she happily agreed and took his place at the gates of heaven, and there her husband arrived. "Well," she said, "I'm surprised to see you here. How are you doing?" And he said, "Well, since you died, I've been doing great. I married that young, beautiful nurse that took care of you while you were sick, and then I sold our small house and bought a big mansion for us to live in, and then I won the lottery. And so I sold everything, and we bought a yacht, and we sailed around the world, and I was water skiing, and I fell, and the ski hit my head, and here I am. Hey, this place looks great. How do I get in?" The woman said, "Well, you have to spell a word." The man said, "Oh, what word is that?" And she said, "Czechoslovakia." It is largely because of the gospel according to Matthew and this passage that we have before us this morning that we have this image of St. Peter guarding the gates of heaven. It is only in the Gospel of Matthew that Peter is handed the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Mark and Luke record that Peter recognized Jesus as the Messiah, but only in Matthew, the first gospel, does Jesus say, "And I tell you, you are Peter," in Greek, Petros, "and on this rock," in Greek, Petra, "I will build my church. I will give you the king's keys to the kingdom of heaven." Reverend Petro, when did you first know that you rocked? This is why Matthew's gospel is the first gospel. It is not because he wrote it first before the others. Church leaders did not order the books of the Bible until the 4th century, by which time the church was an institution with clergy and buildings and power and authority to preserve. And Matthew's gospel emphasizes the institution of the church more than the other three, so it got top billing. The traditional Roman Catholic interpretation of verse 18, that line about Peter being the rock upon which the church is built, is that it establishes the leader of the church in Rome, Peter's church, as the head of all of Christianity. The Bishop of Rome is the Pope. The second half of verse 18, about how the gates of hell shall not prevail against the church, is the foundation for the doctrine of papal infallibility, the assertion that in matters of church doctrine, the Pope cannot be wrong. During the Reformation of the 16th century, the Protestants rejected that part of the interpretation of the verse that elevated the Bishop of Rome. But they were just as happy as the Roman Catholics to claim the authority of the church as an organization. It's Peter's faith, they said, not Peter himself, upon which the church is built. And they were just as happy to keep the keys for themselves also. No one gets through those pearly gates without going through the church. The ultimate job security. So, recognizing that long and winding road that is the history of the interpretation of this passage, let's see if we can set that aside for a moment and read this passage in terms of its biblical context. Because it turns out that this passage is a pivot point in the Gospel of Matthew. Before it, behind it, earlier in the Gospel, are the parables and the teachings and the healing stories. They make up the first half of Matthew's Gospel. And ahead of it, in the second half, are the stories in the Gospel about Jesus heading toward Jerusalem, toward his crucifixion, death, and resurrection. The disciples, those who were alive with him in the first century, and all of the rest of us that have been reading about Jesus in the 2,000 years since, have already seen Jesus feed thousands of people. We have already seen him heal people that no one else would touch. We've seen him upset people who had power and walk without fear despite stormy seas, the seas that would swamp the rest of us. And if we are able to set aside the church's need to establish and authorize its own existence, what we see here is that Jesus was not establishing an institution. He was starting a movement. He wasn't writing doctrine. He was pointing to a God that could never be adequately described with words, but could always be loved through action. Jesus was not building a fortress that had his name carved in stone over the doorway. He was showing us the way to the kingdom, where justice flowed down like water and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. What Peter and the other disciples witnessed and what we witness through the Gospels is a man on fire with the love of God, a man willing to risk public scorn, religious condemnation, and indeed his own life
in order to share that love and that God. What we see is a man whose own willingness and ability to risk it all is not simply the best example of what God wants. It is the manifestation of who God is. He is the Messiah, the Word of God, the Son of God, the Almighty Creator of the universe, wearing sandals. And that's what Peter recognizes. Looking back at what Jesus has done, the hunger he has fed, the brokenness he has healed, the truth he has proclaimed, the risks he has taken, oh, says Peter, I see it. I see God through you. I understand more about God because of you. I receive what God offers me because I receive what you offer me. You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah. Can you hear the relief in Jesus' voice? Someone gets it. Someone finally gets him. For flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church. And then, in the very next few verses, Jesus takes it all back. Starting with verse 21, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and undergo great suffering at the hands of the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and on the third day be raised. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, God forbid it, Lord, this must never happen to you. But he turned and said to Peter, get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me. So Peter gets it, and then he blows it. He understands, and then he misunderstands. He shows keen insight and then pure blockheadedness. He is a rock, and he is a stumbling block, which should give us reason for hope, friends. Because in the end, Peter really does get it, and we are just like him. Give us a mission, we'll form a committee. Inspire us with passion, we will argue over what to call it. Give us something to do, and we'll ask why God didn't take care of this for us. Give us the chance to learn humility and patience, and we'll ask why we're not in charge. Give us unity, we will find the differences. Give us diversity, we will wish we were more alike. Make us a rock and put us in the river to mark the river's flow, and we will join up with other rocks to make a pile. And then we'll fill in the gaps between us until we make a wall. And the wall will stop the flow of the river that we were meant to point to. We will have become an obstacle, a stumbling block to God's movement in the world. I don't know who first said this, but someone put it this way. Jesus came preaching the kingdom, and what he got was the church. Several years ago, I heard Bishop Robert Schnese speak on the future of the church. This is a topic about which Bishop Schnese writes extensively. Methodism, Bishop Schnese said, began with go-to instincts. Back in the 18th century, John Wesley's ultimate concern was for those who did not feel welcome in the Church of England. His mission was to go to them, but Schnese says, we, Wesley's heirs, have become a come-to denomination, expecting people to find us. The late and very great writer and lecturer Phyllis Tickle proposed that about every 500 years, a global upheaval occurs that radically changes the church. So at the turn of the first millennium AD, the split between the Western Church and the Eastern branches of Christianity took place. And then approximately 500 years later, the Protestant Reformation changed that global ecclesial picture once again. And now, Tickle wrote, it's time for something new, one more time. Something new and much, much bigger than any one church or any one denomination, even bigger than any one culture. And no one knows what's ahead. No one knows exactly what this new and transformed church will look like, but surely it will be connected to the realization on the part of the come-to churches that we need to do and be something very different if we are going to be around for the next 500 years. For the times, they are a-changin'. Attending church is not just something that people do every week like they used to. Regular attendance at church officially now means once a month, not once a week. It might mean never coming to this place, but showing up every week online. The global pandemic sped up the pace of this change, but it was on its way long before we even heard the word COVID. If the United Methodist Church and its congregations are going to be around in 100 years, much less 500 years, we are going to have to adjust and adapt. We are going to have to take a hard look at ourselves and ask how we have become stumbling blocks, unintentionally blocking the flow of God's Spirit instead of pointing to it and participating in its movement. Several years ago, when I was serving University United Methodist Church in East Lansing, I challenged my congregation to ask someone who didn't go to church why they didn't go to church, and then to submit their responses. Here are some of the kinds of responses I received back. There were the negative ones. It's boring. The sermons are boring. Occasionally, the music is boring. Most of the people in the church are old. There are not enough activities for young people. Many people in the church seem resistant to change. They project their belief without even saying it, that the way it has been done is the way they will always do it. So there were those negative responses. And then there were the guilty responses. I used to go. I know I should go. Maybe I'll go someday. But the most disturbing responses were received by one person, a 30-something man who staffed our church booth at East Lansing's Pride Parade. "May I ask why you don't go to church?" he asked many people. He got more than a few responses about how individuals had experienced hurt and rejection from their home churches, so much so that they would not even consider trying again. Friends, the impetus is on us, to be stepping stones, not stumbling blocks, to invite, to share, to listen, to welcome, to allow God's Spirit to flow freely, even if it moves in directions that we have never seen before. As Bishop Schnese said, we must move from asking, how can we get other people to change, to asking, what changes are we willing to make? What if worship didn't happen on Sunday mornings? What if people didn't sit in rows? What if it included what looked more like a group conversation than a sermon? What if there was no sermon at all, but there was singing and praying and Holy Communion? What if it involved the use of visual images or tactile activities as much as it involved the spoken word? Maybe that is not how you best connect with God, you who are here on a beautiful Sunday morning in August. But maybe it is the only way someone else is going to find out exactly how much God loves them. Will you be the stumbling stone on someone's path to discipleship? The stepping stone, or will you be the stumbling block that convinces them to give up? What if being church did not necessarily mean having a building? Could we start a new community of disciples who met mostly or even entirely online? What if they did meet in person, but it only happened once a month, and they had coffee and donuts, and then they went off and did a service project in the community? Would that count as church? Maybe it's not your cup of tea, but maybe it is the only way someone else is going to find out exactly how much God loves them. Will we be the stepping stones on someone's path, or the stumbling blocks that convince them to give up? What if the reason we came to Sunday morning worship was just as often because of others as because of ourselves? Could we keep both motivations in our minds and hearts? By which I mean we come needing the music and the prayers and the fellowship and maybe even the sermon, but could we also just as much understand that someone else needs me to wear a name tag and to step up to introduce myself and to explain to them which hymnal we're using and to show them where the restrooms are and to smile when their kid cries? Will we be the stepping stones on someone's path? Or will we be the stumbling blocks that convince them to give up? In just 3 weeks, as Sammy said, Grand Rapids First United Methodist Church will celebrate Homecoming Sunday. Sunday school classes will start back up, and the chancel choir will be back in their seats. There will be even more children following Miss Audrey out the double doors to her left, and maybe there will even be some college students and young adults. The pews and the chairs will be more crowded, and we will have visitors and returnees who have decided it is worth getting up earlier than usual and skipping their morning coffee and crossword puzzle and summoning the courage that is needed to walk into a strange sanctuary filled with unfamiliar faces and unfamiliar ways of doing things. What changes are we willing to make in order to make that effort worthwhile? You, Reverend Petroth, and Darcy, and Tommy, and Jay, and Margie, and Jim, and Janet, and Ed, you are the ones on whom God's church is built. You are the rocks, the foundation of Christ's kingdom in the world. You are the markers on the path that leads to God, disciples who make Methodism's go-to instincts relevant for the 20th century. You are rocks, not stumbling blocks. So a cab driver reaches the pearly gates, and St. Peter greets him there and looks up the name in his big book and says, "Ah, yes, welcome. Take this silk robe and this gold staff and enter the kingdom of heaven." And the cab driver does so willingly. And then a preacher steps up, and St. Peter looks up her name in the big book, and his brow furrows. And he says, "Okay, you can come in. You may have that cloth robe and that wooden staff." And the preacher says, "Hey, I am an ordained woman of the cloth. I belong to the church. Surely I rate more highly than that cabbie." "Ma'am," says St. Peter, with just a little frustration in his voice, "ma'am, here in heaven, we are focused on results. And when you preached, people slept. When the cabbie drove, people prayed."
Thank you.
People of God, this morning I invite you to join me in a responsive prayer, and with all our hearts and with all our minds, let us pray to the Lord, saying, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Holy One, we thank you for this gathered family of worshipers, both here and online. We thank you for the ways each one is offering your love and justice in the world, moving past their comforts and their familiar ways of doing things, and even their own heavy hearts, to follow you and to make space for the other. Let us be worthy of the souls you have entrusted to us in this time and in this place. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all those whose spirits, minds, and bodies are hurting today. We pray, O God, for all those who grieve a loss in their life, the loss of a loved one, the loss of health, the loss of security in a job or home or relationship, for those suffering from anxiety or depression. Be near to the brokenhearted and let them know you are with them, and help us be your comfort to them in times of stress and fear. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the health and restoration of this beautiful earth which God has entrusted to us, and for the wisdom and will to conserve it, not just for this generation, but for generations to come. And we pray especially for the people of Maui as they heal in body, land, and spirit from devastating fire. We call upon your healing presence in the midst of pain and devastation, and ask that you inspire us to bold action to protect your creation and to show up for each other. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all those who are in transition. Keep safe our neighbors, those seeking shelter near to this house of worship, and those who are forging a new home in a new country as they flee from violence and famine and war, seeking protection for themselves and their families. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious God, instill in our hearts the deep desire to be still in your presence and to be that stepping stone instead of a stumbling block, that we might make your heart happy. And seek your face and take somebody's hand and open their hearts. May it be so. Amen.
Thank you.
Family of Christ, go out into the world in peace. Have courage. Hold on to what is good. Return to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the suffering. Honor all persons. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And may the God of peace go with you now. Amen.